I know some of you saw me present before, but what I wanted to do now was give you an overview of what the pumpkin plan's all about, so we really have a sense about it. For me, the next 45, 50 minutes, I'm just gonna give you the overview of that 5% change I wanted to talk about. And then for the rest of the next 2 days, we're gonna go into your businesses, we're gonna go with the people online and go into your businesses and dig into the individual components, make sure that everything in your business is addressed, that 5% change you need to make is being addressed. But start with these words. You don't want to be that guy. I had started my first company. I was in computer networks. And if you don't know what computer networks is, it's boring. I was the guy who would come to your office, finagle with some wires and stuff on your desk when your computer broke, and usually, you know, break it a little bit further, and then charge you $500 to try to get out of there. The computer guy was me, and I was struggling. I was doing... Well, struggling is a relative term. I was doing about $1 million in revenue, but that doesn't mean I was taking home $1 million. And that's the first misperception with entrepreneurship. Your friends here, June, oh, you're an entrepreneur. You must be a millionaire. You're living the life, and all you do is on Craigslist all day. What are you just watching soap operas while you sell and make millions? There's a misperception. So my friends thought I was making millions, but I wasn't. That was the revenue. My business was making a lot less. I was barely making it. I was pulling from savings just to survive, to cover payroll for on a particular day. Well, I hired a business coach. His name was Frank. And Frank came to my office one day and said, I want to just really investigate what you guys are doing and understanding for your business. And he sat me down and my colleagues, and there was like 5 or 6 of us around the table, and Frank started drilling us with questions. He's like, you know, what's your revenue look like? What's your P&L look like? What's the balance sheet? And I'm like, what are those magical words you're throwing at me, you know? And he's like, you don't know this stuff? I'm like, no. And he, for 4 hours, just drilled us with questions trying to understand my business. After that, he says, everyone please get up and leave the room. So everyone got up. I sheepishly got up behind my colleagues and started to scoot to the door. And it's Frank, his last name is Mignotolo. Frank had this accent just like the Godfather. So when he said, like, you don't want to be that guy, he sounded like that. And he looked at me and says, as everyone was getting up to leave, he goes, Michael, you sit down. And if you've ever seen the Godfather, like, that is scary when you hear Michael. So I sat down. And that's when he says, you don't want to be that guy. And I said, well, what guy? You don't want to be the guy who one day ends up in the rusty lawn chair regretting his life. He said, based upon the interview he did with me, that was very clear I was stuck with my actions and decisions. I was going to keep behaving the same way. On the outside, I was going to tell him I'm making change and trying things, but I was really going to act the same way. And he said, every entrepreneur's life is extremely predictable. We are a result where we sit today in this moment of the actions and decisions we made over the last 5 years. We all made active decisions to be here, all of us, at this moment. And in your business, it's the exact same thing. Where your business stands today is because of the actions and decisions you made. And he said from that interview, it was very clear I was stuck in my pattern. In 5 years from today, I was going to be making the same actions, making the same decisions, and be in the same spot of desperation in the same spot, and you go 5 years and 5 years all the way to the rusty lawn chair. And then he went into this like visual description. He goes, can you see yourself, Michael, in the chair? It's this rusty chair. You got your half lemonade like in a sippy cup. I'm like, yeah. He's like, and can you see the hair? I'm like, he goes, not that hair, this hair. And then I'm like, oh man, and the hair coming out of the ears. I said, yeah, I can see that. He's like, do you want that? I'm like, no, of course not. He said, well, just think about it, because that's your future. And he walks to the door, and he turns back around, and he goes, and you don't even want to know what's going on down here. And he walks out. And I'm like, that's a business coach? Like, it's like a sadomasochist. This is not a coach. Like, this is not what you do. He let me sit there thinking about this for like a good minute or two, and he walks back in. And that's when he says, if you want my help, this is the time to ask for it. So I said, I want your help, Frank. And he says, okay. And so tip number one here for everyone listening in our audience out there and for you guys is great sales technique, scare the living hell out of your customer. It definitely works because I hired him on the spot. And Frank then walked me through the process of growing my business. But there was another thing that I struggled with. I was working the entrepreneur's 9-to-5, and the entrepreneur's 9-to-5 is very much different than the rest of the world's 9-to-5. We work from 9 o'clock at night till 5 o'clock in the morning because that's the only time you can get your work done. Because between 9 and 5, customers are calling, problems are happening, you're putting out fires, people you thought you could count on never show up, and then at 9 o'clock at night is when it's quiet enough to start working and you start this exhausting schedule. And I was doing that. And Frank is like, well, this is all you need to do to fix it. And he starts drawing charts and diagrams and stuff all over the place, but it was too much to do it. I consider myself maybe a D student at best at trying to apply what Frank was telling me. But he told me one analogy, and perhaps you've heard this before, that was really powerful. He told me that if a plane takes off from where I live in New York and flies out to here, where we're filming right now in San Francisco, that if it continues its course but it's only off by 5%, if it continues that path off by 5%, the further it travels, the further it gets from its destination. And a plane leaving from New York off by 5% will land in Canada or Mexico. Foreign lands. We land in foreign territory, somewhere we never expected to be, just by traveling off by a little. And that's where he told me it's only this 5% course correction, what we're going to do together over the next 2 days. So Frank tells me about this plane, right? It's off by 5%, and you're going to land in this foreign land. And he's trying to tell me all these techniques to correct my business, that 5% correction. It was overwhelming working my 9-to-5. But then, one day, I'm in my little town in Boonton, New Jersey. I hope there's someone from Boonton, New Jersey watching right now. I'm in Boonton, New Jersey, and I was reading the local paper called The Citizen. And when I call it a paper, I'm being very flowery with my definition of what a paper is, because it was a dot matrix printout. And it was like, it was just basically, you didn't flip through it, you flipped it over because it was a back page. And on the back page was a title that says, New Jersey farmer grows colossal pumpkin, half ton, 1,000-pound pumpkin. I was fascinated, and they had the picture and the guy sitting there leaning against his massive pumpkin like that. And then the journalist asked him, said, how do you grow a massive pumpkin? And his response fascinated me. He said, I only change the growing behavior of a regular pumpkin by 5%. I'm like, Frank said it was 5%. This guy says there's a 5%. Let me interview this guy. And I spent a full year of my life studying pumpkin farmers. And what I want to share in this little introduction to the pumpkin plan is the things you need to change in growing a pumpkin that results in a colossal pumpkin, an ordinary pumpkin to colossal pumpkin, and the same things we need to change in our business that take an ordinary business, perhaps a check-by-check business, or where you're working exhaustively long hours, and turn it into a colossal business. So here's what you need to know about growing a pumpkin. First thing is, if you want to be in the group of colossal pumpkin farmers, we call ourselves Lords of the Gourds. So if you want to be real cool when we go on break and stuff, we'll be calling ourselves Lords of the Gourds. Step one is what's called seed selection. Do you know ordinary farmers go after the biggest quantity of seeds they can collect? The more seeds they can get, the more cheaply, the better they're served. So they collect all these seeds and they throw it over their massive fields, because they're in a quantity game after all. And their big day, it's coming up soon, is Halloween. Halloween, we go out to the massive fields and there's all these pumpkins out there, and you and your children are looking around for the pumpkin for the front stoop at your house or in front of your door. And maybe your child, you know, picks one up and like, Mommy, I want this one. And you're like, that looks like my mother-in-law. We are not getting that one, right? That's what happens at my house. They pick up some odd-looking pumpkins. But for the ordinary pumpkin farmer, this is a great thing. Put as many seeds out as possible, and you'll sell pumpkins. The colossal farmer, their seed selection is entirely different. They go after colossal seeds. They, instead of buying the cheapest seed, look at all the seeds that are available to them, sometimes the most expensive, sometimes not, but they evaluate them under a microscope. They look into the seed to look for the strength of the veinage around the side of the seed. They look for seeds that match the soil content and the humidity and the climate, because they want to pick the seed that has the most potential for colossal growth. In business, ordinary entrepreneurs pick the easy seed. what's my competition doing that I can just copy? I mean, this is how photographers work, so I'm just gonna do what all other photographers do. This is what fine artists do, I'm gonna do what fine artists do. And this is what DJs do, and this is what the specialists in social media, and this is what people on eBay do, and this is what the baby carriage business is all about, and you better copy it. And whatever business we're in, the easy seed is just copying how the industry operates. It's the natural way to go. What I found that colossal entrepreneurs do is they're highly selective of their seed. They pick the equivalent of a colossal seed. And this is what it is. I want you to imagine in your head the Olympic symbol, you know, the big rings there. And on the right side here is the first ring. We have a second ring. If you squish them together, they kind of overlap. Can you see that in your mind's eye? And then there's one more ring down here, and you push it up, and there's three rings. And where they intersect, that intersection in the center is the colossal seed. On the right side, this first ring is called uniqueness. What makes us as business owners really unique? If we could unabashedly express who we are, if we could really be ourselves, who would we really be? And the truth is, it's usually in grade school or kindergarten when we are truly expressive of who we are, when we start behaving like our natural self. And that's when our teachers say, oh, Travis, you can't do that in this class. You gotta conform. And June, oh, the other friends of yours, no, you can't fit in. You gotta look like us. You gotta behave like us. Can't be weird. Kirsten, you can't be weird. You gotta be like us. And there's this pressure from peers and parents and other authorities to comply. But ironically, it's when we were children that we expressed ourselves. If we could recapture that uniqueness that we expressed when we were children, that's still inside of us, and now express it in our business, we started to form the seed. Oscar Wilde wrote the book Dorian Gray. Oscar Wilde has the best saying I have it right above my desk. Donna knows this. It says, be yourself. Everyone else is already taken. That's the definition of uniqueness. And there's historical proof of this in business. This is wildly successful, and there will continue to be. And if you apply, I can't guarantee success, but I can guarantee it's the seeds of success. Apple, it's one of the most heralded cases right now. Everyone talks about Apple, how great Apple computers is. Steve Jobs exploited the uniqueness, something he was picked on for in grade school and high school. Does anyone here that hasn't seen me present before or out there know what it is? Do you guys know what it is? Steve Jobs was made fun of by his peers because of his fear of buttons. Steve Jobs had a button phobia. You'll never see, you can Google it right now out there. You will never see Steve Jobs wear anything but a turtleneck or a buttonless shirt in any historical photos of him because buttons freaked him out. And I can just picture the day his engineering team came up with the first version of the iPhone, the prototype. They said, there's a product out there, it's the Crackberry, you know, with all these buttons. We just, Steve, developed the new iPhone, and we decided to put more buttons on it. It's better. And they probably showed it to Steve Jobs, and Steve was like, and they probably seen out of the Matrix. He's like, get that away, right? And he's freaking out like this because it was not his uniqueness. Steve Jobs said, get rid of the buttons. For God's sake, get rid of the buttons. And Apple, buttonlessness, made art. They made the iPhone, which is a piece of art. In fact, their biggest innovation in buttonlessness is the Apple mouse. If you've seen Apple mouse, it's always a single clicker. Microsoft and IBM and all those products have gone the other way. A Microsoft mouse, it really envelops your hand like you have a glove and like a foot pump, for God's sake. Like, that is a mouse. But Apple exploits Steve Jobs' uniqueness. Uniqueness alone, unfortunately, won't bring us to colossal success. There's a second part of the seed. The second part here on the left is repeating demand from top clients. You see, if you're unique, that's fantastic. But if no one wants it, you're in trouble. I referred to Oscar Wilde. He said, be yourself, everyone else is already taken. Well, if you study Oscar Wilde at all, it ends up he passed away destitute in jail, penniless. Because he had a propensity to expose himself. And there's not too much customer demand for exposing yourself. Hence, destitute. You can be unique, but if no one wants it, you're in trouble. You have to create something that's a true expression of yourselves and customers want it. And when customers buy it repeatedly, they're telling you by their actions, They love what you have. Do it again and do it better. And the third and final element, because perhaps many of you are already there. You do something that's really expressive of yourself. It speaks to you. Some people want it. It's great. But if you don't have the last element, which is systemization, you can never get it beyond just you. And just so we're clear and on the same page of what systemization means where you can attract prospects, have those prospects convert to be customers, pay you, you can render your service, deliver your product, have them thrilled about it, perhaps even refer you to other people, all while you sleep. That's called systemization. If your business can go full cycle while you're unconscious to the world, watch out. Now you have a colossal seed, something that can grow into perpetuity. Second step to growing a colossal pumpkin. It's called sprout analysis. An ordinary farmer, as the sprouts start coming up out of the ground, looks at the sprouts and looks for the weak ones. Because an ordinary farmer is after quantity, after all. They want to grow as much as possible. So they're looking at the ordinary small sprouts, and they try to help them along. They loosen up the dirt. They give it a little hit of water. They sing a lullaby to it. And go, little seed, grow. Colossal farmers focus only on the strongest sprouts. A colossal farmer will see the weak small sprouts and just ignore them because she knows that if a sprout is colossal now, it has potential to go the distance. If it's the strongest sprout, that's what's going to grow the biggest. Ordinary entrepreneurs focus on weaknesses, focus on the weak. Who's the weakest person on my team? Maybe I have a colleague or something who's really not doing well. Maybe I'll help someone else help them out. Or maybe I have a contractor who's not working out so well. Maybe I'll personally coach them to improve them. Or who's my weakest client? Because whoever is my worst client, I'm personally going to devote almost all my attention to fixing this relationship. Focus on the weaknesses. Or the classic, what are my weaknesses? Where am I weak? Because I got to go back to school for that. Ordinary entrepreneurs focus on weaknesses and try to fix it. Colossal entrepreneurs focus on strengths and try to exploit it. They look at the team and say, who are my two or three weak contractors or employees? Instead, they say, who's my strongest one? Because my strongest contractor, I'm going to do everything to remove any distractions for him and allow him to focus on what he does best. And my strongest client? That's the one that's getting all my attention. Because if a client is strong now, and I take care of them, they can go the distance. And maybe they can introduce me to other people just like them, more strong clients. And what's my strengths? Forget my weaknesses. I'm going to find ways to delegate that. That's going to be assigned to Elance or something like that. My strengths? That's what I'm going to do. Because when I exploit my strengths, a strength we can amplify 10 times, a weakness we can fix maybe 0.5%. Yet we focus, ordinary entrepreneurs focus on the weakness. Colossal entrepreneurs focus on strengths. One of the things you can do right now, today, immediately, if you have a client in your business, is look for the strongest client. Once I discovered this process, I didn't first write about it, by the way. I applied it to my own businesses because I knew this would work. My first company, like I told you, I was the computer guy. I was doing computer networks, a very boring business. But what I did was I sat down and I evaluated all my clients, and I want you to do the same. Take your client list and sort it by revenue. Look at all the clients you've had over this last year and sort them out by the revenue that they've generated for you. Most revenue to least revenue. And why this is absolutely critical to your business is clients show their appreciation, how much they need you, by how much they spend with you. It's the action that matters. Inevitably, we listen to words. Inevitably, we say they love me. They love my baby products. They love the Google Hangouts, they tell me. But then they don't buy from us. And the reason people don't do that is because it's socially inappropriate to say anything negative about anyone. I was doing a presentation, actually the same kind of introduction I'm doing for you right now, I was doing in Copenhagen. Is anyone watching from Copenhagen right now? If anyone's watching from Copenhagen, I was right next to Tivoli, and they had this large conference there for mid-cap companies. These are large business professionals. They got $500 million companies and bigger. And there's a conference of 300 people in this audience. One American, by the way. Right? And I'm up there. All the presenters go. They're all, you know, very professional, very good. And then loudmouth American comes up dancing, you know, tap dancing. How's everyone doing? You know, let's get the energy flowing. Well, I'm so into this presentation, I have a board of this size, I have this huge marker, I'm drawing the seed with this big brown marker. Here's your uniqueness, here's your systems. Well, I'm dancing around so much, I'm throwing out so much energy, I start sweating a little bit. As I start sweating, I get this itch on my brow or some water dripping, I gotta wipe it off. I have this huge marker, I come across with the marker, I drew a freaking unibrow! Like, this massive Neanderthal simian unibrow. Like this big. And no one said anything. 300 professionals had opportunities to say something. They said nothing. Now, it was interesting. I noticed something happened. I didn't know what, because the whole audience all of a sudden started taking lots of notes. Everyone started looking down. No one could look at my hideous face. Everyone's like this. I saw a couple people do this thing at me and drawing. And what that points to is we don't speak the truth through our words. We don't. It's socially inappropriate. We speak the truth through our actions. Couldn't look at me. Our clients show their value in us, how much they love us, by spending with us. Never forget this. Truth is spoken through the wallet, not through the words. Truth is spoken through the wallet, not through the words. I want you to take your client list, and you can do it in your mind right now, or you can just jot this down real quickly. It's what client is generating the most revenue for you today and has done that over the last 12 months, the last year. Are any of them buying from you repeatedly? Because that's a big action saying, love you. Other clients, I don't care how fantastic they think your art is. If they're not buying it, you don't really like it. Or if they bought it once, it may have just been a gracious gesture. If they buy it repeatedly, that's when they're distinguishing that they really like what you have to offer. Second thing you need to do with these clients, once you sort them out by the revenue they generate, that's their appreciation for you. Now we need to judge how much you appreciate them. And this is how you do it. It's called the cringe factor. It's real simple. When a client calls, that first client, Travis, when that first client calls on the phone, like, hey, you know, we'd like to buy from you again. You're like, oh my God. They are the worst client in history. All they do is complain. They don't like the art exactly. I have to fix it. I can't stand them. If you're praying that the phone disconnects when you pick up a client, that's a bad thing. It's called the cringe factor. If a client gives you a cringe when the phone rings, you don't love them so much. And here's the God honest truth. If you have two customers that are exactly the same and you love one and you hate one or don't like one, you will perform better for the one you love. Our natural tendency. And we say in our heads, all customers are fantastic. We treat all customers equally. The customer's always right. Not true. The customers we don't like, we subconsciously kind of withdraw. We kind of dodge them. We kind of throw little zingers back at them sometimes. And we can't treat them well. Conversely, that same list where you have the cringe, sometimes you're going to smiley face. Some customers, the phone's going to ring and you're like, yes, it's a holiday. We're going to make some money. And you're thrilled. You're like, I love this customer. They don't complain. I make mistakes with them sometimes. And they allow me to fix it. And then they don't complain about me fixing it. They're just thrilled it got fixed. And they refer me to other people automatically. That's a great customer. That gets a smiley face. And it's the collection of these two factors that start distinguishing your strongest sprouts when it comes to customers. It's not just the money. It's how much you love making that money. And if you have a lot of pride and joy in experiencing or working with this customer, and they're paying you a lot of money, we're on the path to something really successful. If you are making money, even lots of it, and you hate every living moment of it, that's not sustainable. That's not scalable. The third and final column in this little micro assessment of clients is what's called the hourly return. So you look at every single client you have that you have built on this list. The ones that are making you the most money and you love, I want you to do one more thing with them. Determine how much time you spend with them. So if a client makes, say, $1,000 for you and you spend 1 hour doing the work, you made $1,000 an hour. If a client made $1,000 but you spent 100 hours doing the work, you made $10 an hour. Like, go get a job at Mickey D's. You'll make more money there, a lot more. Certain clients give us the biggest return because it's the least effort and we love working with them. And it's big money overall, they spend a lot with us. Those are the perfect clients. And when we start identifying who the perfect clients are, we have an opportunity to start cloning them. I mean, just imagine for a second, your very favorite client. What if you had 10 of them? What if you had like 20 of them? Wouldn't it change your business dramatically? It does for, would for me, would for anybody. And so my own business as the computer guy, I went through this assessment. My number one client was a bank in New Jersey, so I will not reference their name because I have a feeling they might be watching too. But there was a bank in New Jersey who spent a lot of money with me, but they were a big cringe because sometimes, more often than not, they would prepare to spend a lot of money with me. They'd say, we have this big project we want to do with you, Mike, and then they would back out last minute. Oh, the board of directors didn't approve it. Oh, we can't do it. I'm sorry, all that computer equipment you acquired and all the people you brought on board to come out to our offices starting tomorrow, cancel everything. We'll reconnect with you in 6 months.
It was killing me.
Ironically, it was the number two financially that was actually my favorite client. It was a company called Appaloosa in Chatham, New Jersey. And Appaloosa Management was run by this guy named Larry. Larry was the guy who talked with me all the time. And when Larry would call me, he'd say, Mike, we heard there's some new technology coming out specific to our industry. We need to upgrade our computers. Can you get it done next week? And can you come in at such and such time? And every time Larry sent that, he'd hang up the phone, and I'd walk over to the post office box and open it because a check was arriving. He was that on top of things. So I was like, this guy's awesome. I'd open the check, order the computers, and go. And it was like clockwork. I loved Larry. And I recognized, once I discovered the pumpkin plan, that if I could make like 5 Larrys or 10 Larrys, game over. My company would grow explosively. And that $1 million top line and barely surviving bottom line would change forever. I knew it. So here's what you do. And here's what I did. Once you identify your top clients, ask them to go to lunch, meet with them, spend time with them. Learn everything you can to get inside their mindset. Why are you selecting me? What value driving from me? So I called Larry on the phone and said, hey, Larry, I want to come out and pick you up and take you out to lunch. For some businesses, by the way, it's impractical. Our clients are in another state or whatever. Still go to lunch with them. For God's sake, get on a plane and do it. It's going to be the smartest marketing investment ever. The $500 plane ticket and the $200 in hotel and food expenses will more than cover itself once you get inside the mindset of your best clients, because you're going to learn how to replicate them. That's how important this process is. So I went out to lunch with Larry, and I just started asking questions. I asked him every question I could to understand how hedge funds operate and why a computer guy would be significant in helping him. Like, what could we do to improve ourselves? I ultimately found there's three key questions you need to ask every one of your best clients. Question one is, what am I doing that's working? What am I doing that's right? Now, here's why this is such an important question. What the client responds to you with, they are telling you what they are noticing. So when I said, hey, Larry, what am I doing right as a computer guy? He said, you know, you show up right on time every single time. So promptness is something he's noticing. And he goes, you know, when we have an emergency, you guys get on site within like a couple hours and start helping out. That's a big deal. What I discovered was, or what I knew then when Larry told me that, was if he notices I'm getting on site within 2 hours, how do I get on site within 10 minutes? Because that will blow his mind. It's something he notices. When clients tell you you're doing something right, you have an opportunity to exploit, to build on that, and do it at a remarkable level they never experienced before, because it's something they already notice. The second question to ask, what am I doing wrong? But here's the thing. If you ask, what am I doing wrong, they will lie to you, unibrow. They will lie to you. No one wants to tell you about your ugliness. So you ask your client, what am I doing wrong? And they're like, oh, you know, everything's pretty good. Liars! So you can't ask that question. Instead, ask, what is my industry doing wrong? And this is how I did it with Larry. I said, hey, Larry, you've probably worked with other computer guys. I'm not your first, like, computer guy. You've had computer guys before me. A little tear comes down. I said, what do you think about the computer industry? What's wrong with my industry? And that's when Larry said, oh, you know, computer guys like you, your bill rates are awfully high, and sometimes you charge like ridiculous amounts for stupid things. I remember him telling me a story. This is when the Palm Pilot was a big deal. He goes, we bought a Palm Pilot for $200, and you charged $500 to install it. I consider that a ripoff. I hate that about you, and about the industry. And what he was telling me was what he doesn't like about the industry was really the egg on my face, what he didn't like about me, stuff I had to fix and resolve and come up with a new way so that he'd be content. And the third question that you have to ask is, what other vendors do you depend on? What other vendors do you depend on? Other vendors that work with you right now and that you depend on. And that question is a juicy one. It can change businesses prolifically, so I will share a little more detail on that in a minute. But that's the three questions. The third step to growing a colossal pumpkin is the watering process. You know, the ordinary farmer uses a saturation system. You can see out the country roads out right out of the city here. Anywhere you live, there's these massive saturation systems, these big pipes that roll on these tires. You ever see these? They come across. You've probably never seen them running, by the way. They don't run during the day. There's too much evaporative effect. So they kick off at night, and they go very slowly across the fields, pumping as much water into the plants as possible. And the idea behind this is you got one shot at giving water to the plants, pump it in. It's a very ordinary farming approach. The colossal farmer uses a process called saturation. What they do is they crank in as much they crank in just enough amount of water into a plant, and then they walk away. And then, once the roots have absorbed it, they crank in a little bit more water and crank in a little bit more. In the quenching process the colossal farmers use, you hit a plant with water up to 20 times a day to maximize the absorption of water. Ordinary entrepreneurs, saturation, perhaps you've experienced it, hopefully you're not doing it. Saturation is where, like, oh my God, I need to sell. I gotta sell. I'm just gonna go anywhere and everywhere and just blast out what I do. DJ for hire, I don't care what it is, DJ for hire, and you're just yelling it out to everybody. And perhaps you've even experienced this, you go to like a networking event, and that one, you'll sit in there and you have your donut and you have like a coffee and you're sitting there and you're chit-chatting it up, like, hey, how many kids? I don't have any kids. Oh, I didn't know, you know, talking. And then all of a sudden the door opens and a guy comes in and he's got like, it looks like he's got two guns on his hips and it's all business cards. And everyone sits there and everyone's like, oh God, here we go. And that guy lines up and says, he starts sticking at the cards at everybody, right? Take my card, here's what I do, buy from me. And you're sitting there and you're like eating your donut, you're just biting into it, and the guy comes up to you and he's like, ah, he just jams it in your mouth, and you're like, ah, and he continues on. And that guy goes home and then wonders, why am I not getting any business? Because he's saturating. He's hitting the roots too hard, too fast. You can't develop a relationship that way. Colossal entrepreneurs use a quenching process. They simply go to the same spot and they give just enough, just enough, just enough. When I when I sat down with Larry, the hedge fund guy, and started asking him, like, you know, where do hedge funds hang out? Where do you guys go? And he told me, well, this was during our lunch. He says, well, I said, do you read like Inc. magazine, for example? Like, I love Inc. or Entrepreneur magazine or Fast Company. And he said, no, I don't read those. You know, all the hedge fund guys read this magazine called Mar Hedge. I said, oh, okay. I'm like, where do hedge funds hang out? Like, where do you guys network? Do you go to the Chamber of Commerce or you know? He's like, no. He's like, we go to the two hedge fund conferences. There's one in Greenwich, Connecticut, and one in Long Beach, California. I was like, oh. So that day, nothing against the Chamber of Commerce. It's an awesome platform, but not for my top clients. I left the Chamber of Commerce and went to these two events every single day. And then I stopped reaching out to Inc. magazine and Entrepreneur. I still read it for my own interest, but I wasn't going to try to do any advertising for them. I called Mar Hedge. And I called this little magazine and said, hey, I heard you're a magazine for hedge funds. I'm a technology guy, and I got a hedge fund client. Is there anything I could do with you guys? And they're like, you know, we're kind of looking for a journalist. Would you be willing to write hedge fund technology articles? And they said, there's one caveat. We can only pay you $150 an article. I'm like, I love the caveat. Give me money. I'll advertise to them all day. I'm getting paid to advertise to my best clients. Question for you is, where do your top clients hang out? Ask them and then start appearing there. Go there frequently. The power of frequency is pretty amazing. When I started going to the hedge fund locations, when I was appearing in Greenwich, Connecticut and in Long Beach, California, people started seeing me frequently. And the more frequently they started seeing me, they started trusting me. And I didn't need to go and start pushing cards. I just started appearing. And frequency, face-to-face time, builds no like and trust, right? And then they started buying from me. Just by appearing where the hedge funds were appearing, within a year, I picked up about five more Larrys. Five more companies just like Appaloosa. Huge business for me. Huge business for me. Frequency is such a powerful thing. A lot of people say, well, that doesn't work. I need to market like crazy. Frequency is so powerful, it's worked on all of us. If you've ever seen like a Coke commercial, it's worked on you. It's worked on us. This is how it works. You're watching the Olympics. It was like the London Olympics. You know, Michael Phelps is going to win like the 100 billionth gold. The most awarded Olympian of all time. He comes out of the water in this race, and Brett Musburger comes on. And he's like, Michael Phelps just won the gold. We're going to go to the gold medal ceremony. This is incredible. And then they cut to commercial. And you see this pristine Coca-Cola bottle sitting there, and there's like a bead of sweat dripping down. And you look at it, and all of a sudden, like a polar bear hand comes up and grabs it, which is bizarre, which is very bizarre, right? And this polar bear like chugs it down, but whatever. Coke knows not a single one of us is watching the Olympics and going, oh my God, I should be drinking Coca-Cola right now. What am I doing? I'm out of here, and run into the food store. Coke doesn't want that. Coke is achieving frequency. The more frequently we see someone or something, the more we trust it. And Coke knows every time that logo's in front of our face, chances are we trust the brand that much more. Chances are, next time you go to the food store, if you are in the market for a soda, and you see a liter of Coke and a liter of generic soda, you have the propensity to buy the Coke. And the ironic thing is, logically, we know the ingredients are the same. It's carbonated water, caramel color, and sugar, and lots of it. And they're literally identical. But, and the Coke costs a dollar more, we buy the Coke because we trust the brand more. That's the power of frequency. Frequency is so powerful that when you drink the Coke, you're like, this is distinctly good. This tastes so much better than the generic soda, so much better than any other alternative brand, right? Frequency actually changes our brain operation to actually taste things differently. There's been so many tests about this. When people do blind taste tests of different products, they can't determine the product. When they see the logo first, like, oh, that's definitely a Coke. There's been wine tests. This is my favorite example. There's been wine tests. We put down a bottle, and they say, this one's $50 a bottle, and this is $7 a bottle. Which one tastes better? They taste it. The $50 bottle wins out every time. They do the exact same thing. They pour it in a blind taste test. People can't tell the difference. They're both exceptional. What we see frequently and what we hear then predetermines how we're going to judge our experience. We as entrepreneurs have a huge opportunity here. We don't have a Coca-Cola budget. I get it. But if we know who our best clients are, our top seeds, and we appear there frequently, they're going to start seeing us more and more, where they're going to be steeped in us. They're going to value us more and more. They're going to have a better experience with us. They're going to want us to win. That's the power of frequency. That's the power of quenching, not saturating. Two more things I wanted to share about the overview of the pumpkin plan, and then we're going to dig into this in such detail, and we're going to be going back and forth with lots of questions. That's what I'm really fired up about. But two more things you need to know. The fourth process to growing colossal pumpkin is called root analysis. And don't worry, this isn't a math test or something like that. It's not that kind of root, square root math. The root, like under the ground. Do you know the ordinary pumpkin farmers don't care so much about the root system? They look at the surface level. If you're an ordinary farmer, you're in the quantity game. The more pumpkins you can grow, the more quickly for Halloween, the better you're served. So everything's at the surface level. You sit in your big old tractor, you shoot down the farm, and you're just looking for signs of blight or disease. If there's a lot of plants that are showing disease, you throw down some pesticides, some chemicals, and hopefully you're back into the quantity game. Colossal farmers wear these crazy freaking goggles that like the FBI has, firefighters use, that can literally see through walls. And they put these goggles on, and they look to seek underground the health of the root system. Because a colossal farmer recognizes the root represents, and can get to this size, by the way, the entire health of the plant. A root in the final growing days gets to this size and can pump in 50 pounds of weight onto a growing pumpkin. True, you can put your ear to the ground, usually during night, that's when the plant takes in the most water. You can hear the water rushing into the plant. And if a gopher or some disease or something happens to that root system, game over. The entire plant dies. So colossal farmers know it's what's happening underground that matters. So what's the analogy to entrepreneurs? Do you know ordinary entrepreneurs? Very surface level. They do surface level maneuvers all the time, and the most common one I see is with clients, we ask for client referrals. This is so commonplace that we've actually been trained on this. I suspect that someone somewhere has told you, you gotta ask for client referrals. And I found That's a very ordinary practice. An ordinary entrepreneur does this. We'll go to a client and say, hey, I just delivered my product to you. How was your experience? It was fantastic, and I had a great time. A great experience, and I love your product. Then we say, okay, they loved it, which are probably lying to you, socially appropriate, but they say it. We then are told to do this. Well, if you love the product so much, would you happen to have other friends or acquaintances that could potentially also use the product that I could contact? And then they say, yeah, sure. Probably also lying to you. They don't want to give it to you. And then we always think it's kind of weird. We get the phone number they write down or the email. We get the phone number and we open the paper that they gave us. And we're like, 555. Like, I thought that was just in the movies. Like, how can you call that number? You can't. If you think from the client's perspective, giving referrals is a bad move. Why? Because they're diluting their attention. Anne just gave me great service, and now she's asking me for a referral. If I refer to one of my friends, I don't get Anne's attention anymore. I'm diluting her attention. And it's even offensive to me. I just gave her good money for her service and her product, and she's saying it's not enough. I gotta give her more. Colossal entrepreneurs don't go for client referrals. They make them happen automatically through remarkable service, and they go for the vendor well. Remember that question I said, never forget this question, what other vendors do you depend on? This is where it comes into play. I asked Larry, the hedge fund guy, I said, what other vendors do you depend on? And he came back and said, well, why do you care what other vendors do I depend on? I said, Larry, if I know the guy that cleans the office here and I connect with them, maybe I'll find out when I set my computers, I'm putting cables and stuff in the wrong spot. And then when they're doing their vacuum and cleaning, like I'm messing up the whole cleaning process. So maybe we can collaborate. And Larry said, Mike, you're the first person ever to ask me that. That's genius. I want you to connect with my vendors because you can serve me better. You see, by asking the question, what vendors do you depend on, you're not diluting your attention to the client, you're focusing it. I'm trying to serve Larry better. So Larry introduced me to a few of his vendors. One company is called iMatrix, which made trading desks, the cleaning guy, and some other people. I then called them up and said, hey, we have a mutual client. We both serve Larry. They're like, oh, Larry's awesome. I'm like, I know. He's my client too. Like, why don't we collaborate? I'm the computer guy. You're the trading desk guy, is one guy I called. I said, I put my computers on your trading desk. We should connect and serve Larry better. So the meeting was a no-brainer. We had a mutual client. I meet with this trading desk guy. He then tells me that when I go out there and set my computers, that I'm putting the data cables for the computers in the wrong spot. And he has to pull them out. He has to yank out the cables when we set up our computers when he expands the desk because it's in the wrong spot. He's a cable yanker. So I was like, oh my God, that's every time you guys change the desk around, we were having computer problems. I didn't realize we're messing something up. And Larry was getting upset. Every time they expanded the desk for new traders, new brokers, the computers were going down. When the trading desk guy told me we'd put the cable, we never had a problem again. Larry, our mutual client, was thrilled. The trading desk guy was thrilled. No more problems. No more computer problems. And the real miracle happened about, I don't know, maybe it was a month or two after we started working together with Larry, our mutual client. The trading desk guy called me and said, I got another hedge fund, just like Larry. We're setting up their trading desk. They haven't picked a computer guy yet. Would you be interested? And I'm like, yes, extremely interested. And they introduced me to hedge fund after hedge fund after hedge fund. And my company went from $1 million top line, dying bottom line, to $2 million top line, very profitable bottom line. Because I was replicating my best clients. The ones with the best hourly return were coming in over and over and over again. Colossal entrepreneurs that want to grow their business focus on the vendor network. And they master it. And they master the vendor network around serving and replicating those top clients. The final step to growing a colossal pumpkin is the pruning process. And we're going to dig into this into big detail over the next couple days. But this is how pruning works. If you're an ordinary farmer, you don't prune so much. You're in the quantity game. More pumpkins, the better. Colossal pumpkin farmers prune like crazy. If a little pumpkin starts growing up on the vine and they have a colossal pumpkin here, the colossal farmer will remove that pumpkin immediately. Because he knows if that pumpkin, that little one's allowed to grow, it's stealing nutrients and water away from the colossal pumpkin. And interestingly, the colossal pumpkin farmer doesn't say, oh, little pumpkin, we had such a good rapport together. I'm going to give you 5 weeks notice and a severance package to join another patch. He removes it instantly. And colossal entrepreneurs do the same thing. Colossal entrepreneurs have the discipline to say no to the little pumpkins and turn them away a lot. Because they know every time they say yes to a little pumpkin that they're taking away nutrients from what's colossal. And the little pumpkins, by the way, are often labeled as opportunities. Ordinary entrepreneurs love opportunities. Oh, here's an opportunity, little pumpkin. Oh, here's an opportunity, little pumpkin. Oh, I should be doing this. Oh, I could do this. And it's constantly growing little pumpkins. Colossal entrepreneurs, after going through this process, know what their colossal pumpkin is and protect it with their life. A little pumpkin comes up, an opportunity, and they say, nope. If it doesn't feed my colossal pumpkin, nope, nope, nope. There's actually been studies, the most successful entrepreneurs, say no to opportunities 10 times more than they say yes. Struggling entrepreneurs say yes to opportunities 10 times more than they say no. One final thing I wanted to share is a lot of people say, okay, Mike, I get this. I'm revved up for the next 2 days. We're gonna apply this to my business, but it sounds a little bit risky. You're saying, focus on a niche, dominate the niche, block other things. If opportunities sprout up that aren't fitting that, you're telling me to get rid of them, that's risky. That's a little too risky for me. I want a guarantee. I want an absolute guarantee that this is gonna work for me. Well, good news. I have an absolute guarantee for you. Unfortunately, the guarantee is with the ordinary pumpkin farmer. You know, ordinary pumpkin farmers are guaranteed never to grow a colossal pumpkin. We will never drive down any country road anywhere in this world in a huge pumpkin farm, and all of a sudden, miraculously, a colossal pumpkin just sprouted out of the patch. The ordinary process of the quantity game prohibits colossal growth. It can't happen. The only way to grow a colossal pumpkin is by focus. Now, interestingly, as I studied these colossal farmers, I found that sometimes it doesn't work out. Sometimes a pumpkin starts growing so quickly, it actually collapses under its own weight. Other times, it just doesn't sprout, doesn't take off. And sometimes the season isn't right. The weather conditions aren't right. It just comes down and snowing in the summer or hail and it destroys the pumpkin field. But what was fascinating about the colossal farmers is none of them said, oh, the process is broken, I gotta try a different way. They went back to the shed, picked the next colossal seed, and started the process over again. All they said was, it wasn't my season. And that's what I found with colossal entrepreneurs too. What you're about to learn over these next 2 days is the process. There is no other process. This is how you grow a colossal business. And we'll share case studies and proof that this works. And you're gonna start even experiencing it, I believe, in your own businesses as you sit here or as you watch. The thing is, no one can guarantee success, because the perfect process has to match up with the perfect season. And that's something none of us has control over. But if you follow the process and the season plays into your favor, you're gonna spark colossal growth. And if the season doesn't match up, you have to have the courage, and we hope to inspire that, I hope that inspire that in you, to stick it out for yet another season and another season until your process works.